Blog Talk Radio, the world's largest online radio network.
Here we go, week number 9 of the FantasyGuru.com Sunday Night Wrap-Up Podcast. Paul Kelly, Adam Kaplan. You can follow Adam on Twitter, at KaplanNFL. And Adam, good to be back with you on a Sunday night for the first time this year.
Yeah, I've not done one of these in I don't know how long, but because the Eagles play Monday night, I work for PhiladelphiaEagles.com Monday night versus the Saints. So I've been rare. It's just a rare Sunday where I'm home. I seem never to be home on Sundays, but a couple times this year I've been able to, and it was good to watch football on Sunday. It was fun.
Well, we got a lot to get to. We'll take you through all the games, matchup by matchup. We'll let you know exactly what went down. We'll fill you in on the key injuries, everything you need to know here. And we'll get started in Cincinnati, where the Bengals were at home taking on the Broncos today. Broncos win it 31-23. What can you say about Peyton Manning? He throws for 291, three more scores this week. He's on pace for almost 5,000 yards, Adam. This is crazy what he's getting done this season. Probably going to throw for 40 touchdowns as well. And when you look at the guys that he's throwing to, Demaryius Thomas, Eric Decker with two more touchdowns today, these guys are just flat out getting it done every week now.
Yeah, and you know Manning had a couple picks, and this has been a great story because when you look at Denver, looked ugly for them earlier in the season. Their defense was not playing well. Now their defense has come on a little bit. They're getting pressure on the quarterback. Decker, who got off to a slow start this season, has been coming on. He's scoring a lot of touchdowns. You know, their offense is it's very easy to see what they're going to do every week. It's Thomas on a bubble screen, Thomas downfield. He had the 45-yard catch. Decker, short area. Decker, red zone. Dreesen, red zone. There's your offense for the Broncos. And McGahee got stymied today. I have to give the credit to the Bengals. They did a fantastic job against McGahee. Hey, give Cincinnati credit. But the thing is, Manning gets rid of the football so quickly, Paul. They just cannot get to him as much as they would have liked. And in the end, they did not get a sack, and Manning still got it done.
For Cincinnati, Andy Dalton continues his uneven play, 26 of 42 for 299 and a touch. Also had one INT on the day. Did do a better job this week, though, of getting the ball to A.J. Green. Their last time out, he only had one catch, I think, for 8 yards. Today, 7 for 99 and the touchdown. And Jermaine Gresham very involved today, too.
Yeah, Gresham, another guy, got off to a slow start, has really been coming on. We said it all season. They don't have a number two passing option. He is it. It's all you really need to know. They struggle to find Andrew Hawkins the ball. He had that really nice 18-yard catch, bounced off a couple guys. Sanu had the 34-yard catch, but this is something they've got to do in the offseason. Brandon Tate started over Binns. Binns has done nothing. Something the Bengals must do on offense, they've got to draft or sign a receiver who could start opposite Green because they just don't. It's killing them that they don't have that second receiver. Gresham, as we called all season, would be the second passing option. Couldn't be any more obvious, and he is. He's really come on here. He's doing a great job, and he's sort of he's a run after the catch, big play tight end. And when he brings his A game and he concentrates, he does a good job.
Yeah, Gresham, 5 or more catches now in 4 of his last 6. So he certainly seems to be coming on. On the ground, Ben Jarvis, Green Ellis usually doesn't do much for fantasy unless he scores. He did score today for you. 17 carries, 56 yards, which is nothing special, but you'll take that touchdown if you needed BGE to get it done for you today. Let's move on and go to Baltimore and Cleveland. The Ravens back on track this week. They win 25-15. And Adam, you and I talked about this a bit Friday. They need to get the ball to Ray Rice more. They did it today. 27 touches, 104 yards, and a touchdown. He looked pretty good today.
He did. You know, he got off to a good start. Then, he's not – the thing that he's not doing this season, and he is scoring touchdowns, which is great, but he's not getting the explosive plays that you like, but he's still running – just under 5 yards a carry, but I'm not seeing a lot of big plays, but he's getting a lot of 5-7 yard carries and so forth. So far, he's getting the job done. You know, first couple of years, he was not a big touchdown guy, but he's getting it done this season. He just has 5 touchdowns. Receptions, not very good, though, Paul. Only 29 on the season. Expected a lot more than that.
Joe Flacco throws for 153 yards, the one touchdown to Torrey Smith, and Joe Flacco has thrown for under 200 yards now in 3 of his last 4. He hasn't thrown multiple touchdowns in a game since week 3. I mean, at this point, you just can't use the guy.
No, he's just a backup. And honestly, I think when you look at their situation, they're lucky that they're not having to throw a lot because they've got one guy who can make an explosive play in Torrey Smith. Dixon and Pitta are just not consistent players. And Bolden is a possession guy. That's all they have. It's another team. They must draft another receiver. They've got to do a better job there. And defensively, listen, they've got a ton of injuries. I give them credit, though. They were behind, then they held serve. And Whedon, it's the wheels are falling off here. This is two terrible games in a row. The previous week, clearly weather. I got that. This week, Trent Richardson did a nice job. He gets the job done on the ground, but it's another team. They're having problems getting consistent passing options every week. Gordon and Whedon didn't hook up. There was one play they really should have hooked up for, which would have been explosive. Good to see Richardson catch the passes here, but for people in fantasy, it's been a struggle to kind of figure out who's going to catch the ball offensively.
Trent Richardson, 25 carries, 105 today. Didn't score, but caught 6 passes for 31 yards. He's on pace for about 55 catches on the year, which is fantastic. You'd love to see that in the PPR.
Yeah, he picked it up this week. It'd been a while since he had a big catch game. But, yeah, listen, he was one of the better receiving backs to come out, including Doug Martin, who we'll get to later. I think when you look at Richardson, he has 25 catches on the season. But the big explosive plays in the running game, clearly not there, only averaging 3.7 yards per carry. But today, I like that they fed him the football. And quite frankly, they don't keep doing that because they cannot get it done in the passing game.
Next game up, we go to Lambeau Field, Green Bay 31, Arizona 17. This game was pretty competitive throughout, a little bit surprised. But for the second week in a row, Aaron Rodgers, at least for the yardage numbers, not really all you expect them to be. Last week, under 200 yards. Today, just 218 on 14 of 30 passing. Very uncharacteristic for him. He did toss 4 touchdowns, though, so certainly you're not complaining about it. And I mean, he's averaging almost 4 touchdowns per game now over his last 6. So yard number's not there, but the 4 TDs, you're going to take it.
Yeah, now it's interesting. He actually said after the game he did not play well. And we've seen a couple games this season where it's just been off with his accuracy. This was one of them. James Jones, again, gets a start. He gets 7 targets, 4 for 61 and a touchdown. Cobb got hurt, left the game for a bit, came back. He had 1 catch later. Did have the 2 touchdowns, and then Jordy Nelson, now he has 2 different injuries. His ankle injury,
yep,
and with the hamstring, they do have the bye, which will help him, but that's not good. That's a big problem. Alex Green and Starks are now in a timeshare. Alex Green seemed to have a lot of carries second and third quarter, and Starks finished because he's more physical. If you're an Alex Green guy, you are now in a timeshare. That's his problem. He earned that, but he didn't run Bailey 11 for 53. Tom Crabtree had the catch over the middle for a touchdown. But I think when you look at Rodgers, he's on pace for touchdowns of last year because he's putting up in bunches now. But I think when you look at it, he's just a little bit off with his accuracy. But not having Greg Jennings, Paul, I think is part of it.
Yeah, and if you're playing in a 24-team league, maybe you had Tom Crabtree in your lineup today with that
right.
long touchdown.
Exactly.
But, the Cardinals, we knew it was going to be rough sledding for them, especially running the football. Lerod Stevens-Howling did score today, so if you needed him, he did come through with that. But just 17 carries for 51 yards, we knew it would be tough for him. We knew Skelton was going to have to throw it a ton. He did, 46 attempts in the game, went for over 300 yards. The touchdown to Larry Fitzgerald, thankfully, if you've been starting him. He did score today. But how about Andre Roberts, who really putting together a nice season here? 4 catches,
yeah.
86
yeah.
yards. I mean, if you project him out for the rest of the season, he's going to come close probably to 1,000 yards on the year.
Yeah, one thing, Paul, I'm not just a numbers guy. Actually, I watch these games, and I see Skelton is just an inaccurate quarterback, and this is something we need to point out for whether you're a Cardinals fan, because we don't just have fantasy people listening. We actually have NFL fans, and it's really disappointing. I thought he'd be a much better NFL quarterback. Now, Skelton, I get it. Offensive line's horrendous. But he misses guys every game that are wide open. They're not getting anything out of the tight end. Other than Hauser did make the nice catch over the downfield. Todd Heap has not played in almost 2 months. They need help there with the offensive line. That is something they will do in the offseason is build it. And Stephen Talling, he's been a little bit better than I thought. But that's another team. Ryan Williams got hurt again. They've got to figure this out with the running game. They just cannot run the football. Andre Roberts, as you said, he's been a nice surprise here. He had 7 targets. I liked him as a reach this week because the Packers' defense has been struggling mightily lately. And Michael Floyd, now this is another guy you got to keep an eye on. 5 for 80 and 7 targets. You know, I'm going to keep an eye on him because this is a bad team right now that has really no chance to make the playoffs. This is what they've lost 5 in a row. You might see Michael Floyd now playing a lot more.
Yeah, you touched on Rob Housler, a tight end. The last 3 weeks, 5 catches, 4 catches, and then 5 catches again this week. As long as Heap is not playing, is he somebody to look at possibly on the waiver wire for depth?
He is a major athletic talent at tight end. He played at Florida Atlantic. He could run. He played with Alfred Morris there, the running back for the Redskins, and Rusty Smith, the quarterback for the Titans. This guy is a big-time talent, and the problem is he's not real big. He needs to get bigger physically, but he can catch. He's a dynasty league guy. You need to take a look at him. The biggest problem is they don't have a quarterback to get him the football. He did have 9 targets, which is pretty significant, and the thing is now, because their defense is falling off and they can't run the football, they're throwing it like crazy. So, yeah, you make a good point. I mean, this might be a guy to keep an eye on.
Hey, Adam, do me a favor. I think we may be beginning to lose you here. You're beginning to chop up on us.
Okay.
I'm going to disconnect. Just call right back in, and I'll reconnect you in.
All right.
So we're going to say goodbye to Adam here. We'll welcome him back in here in a second. Meanwhile, we will go ahead and get started. Buffalo at Houston. And, boy, the Texans won this game 21-9, a little bit closer than I think a lot of people thought that it would be. And, you know, Adam and I talked about this on the radio on Friday. You look at a game like this, you figure Houston is going to control it throughout. And let's see if we can get Adam back in here.
I am.
Hey, Adam.
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can hear you. And just getting into Buffalo and Houston now, Adam, and talking about how you and I had mentioned on Friday on Sirius that you look at a game like this, you figure Houston is going to control it all the way through. It didn't really play out that way.
Nope.
But, you know, when you talk about garbage time running backs, a lot of us thought that Justin Forsett with Ben Tate out might get some opportunities to do something here. He did carry 6 times, but just 7 yards. But this game didn't exactly play out exactly the way we thought that it would.
No, I would back way off on these blowout reaches, Paul. I wouldn't even do them. I think it's a waste of time. When you need wins, why take a chance on that? I think you have to move on from using guys like that. You know, the good thing is they fed Foster, and you knew that was going to happen. Their pass-run ratio was almost 50-50. I think when you look at this situation, the good thing coming out of the bye is that Andre Johnson looked very, very good. He looked explosive. He doesn't score touchdowns. Daniels, though, Paul, is scoring touchdowns. He's been very, very good this season, very solid.
Daniels, if you project him out for the second half of the year here, if he maintains the pace, he's going to catch 74 balls, close to 1,000 yards, double-digit touchdowns. Just having a really nice year for the Texans. Matt Schaub throws for 268 today, a couple of scores, 1 to Daniels, 1 to Graham. And we'll take it over to Buffalo. We figured this would be a tough spot for them offensively. I'm very surprised Ryan Fitzpatrick didn't throw any picks in this game. I really thought that he was going to have a lot of trouble.
He did have a fumble.
Didn't throw a pick, though. 25 of 38 for 239. And interesting that, you know, he throws for 239, completes 25 passes, but only 3 of them to Stevie Johnson today.
You know, it's so hard to watch Fitzpatrick. He's struggling so badly. This game is more accurate, but, they couldn't get any plays downfield. Donald Jones is actually in PPR. He's not terrible. He had 9 targets today, 6 for 65. The biggest abomination is the game was never out of hand. C.J. Spiller, only 11 touches. Fred Jackson, only 11 touches. Chan Gailey, one of the many reasons why he's going to be fired is he doesn't understand how to call a game. This is just they're struggling to find scoring, Paul. When you're in a tight game where the game is within reach, find ways to get the ball in your – with the guys who make explosive plays. They just did a terrible job. And he had to make excuses after the game, but no one's buying it. So this team's bad. I mean, they're bad. I'd bail on everyone there. Honestly, you've got Spiller. Knowing that you don't know how they're going to use him, I mean, I'd love to trade the guy, but you have to look at what kind of roster you have and what you'd be able to get for him. But quite frankly, he's just not a guy that you know is going to get the ball consistently.
Yeah, that's the problem. I mean, you talk about getting the ball in the hands of your playmakers. For the Bills, that is C.J. Spiller, a guy who coming into this week was averaging over 7 yards per carry. Week after week, now that Fred Jackson is back in the fold, these guys are splitting touches pretty much 50-50, and every week C.J. Spiller is doing more with those touches than Freddie Jackson is, and you wonder if at some point they finally get to the point where they say, okay, C.J. is going to be our guy, and maybe we divide up these carries 2-1 for C.J. Spiller.
No, exactly. Well, they'll never do that because their problem is they just don't think Spiller could handle a lot of carries. And that may be true, but you know what? Use him as a receiver in the passing game, which they did today, 5 for 63. But they're just having trouble figuring out how many times use him in the running game and to get those explosive plays. I don't know. It's hard to watch them. This thing is spiraling out of control over the Bills.
Let's move on. We'll go to Miami and Indianapolis in a tight game. The Colts win 23-20 behind 433 passing yards today from Andrew Luck. Two touchdowns as well, one to Reggie Wayne, who catches 7 more passes. He's on pace for over 120 grabs on the year. But T.Y. Hilton caught the other touchdown, 6 for 102 in that grab today. Clearly they're making an effort to try and get him the ball. He also dropped one in the end zone. Could have had even more fantasy points for you. But if he's out there on your waiver wire, I think you go out and get him right now.
Listen, they've been trying all season, but the timing's been off with him and Luck, and they finally started hitting on it because they've been trying Avery. Now, Avery got it together this game. You know, Avery is not converting a lot of the targets, but Avery and Hilton got it done, combining for 11 catches, 210 yards and a touchdown and 19 targets. And Avery, you know, he's a deep guy, and so is Hilton. Wayne was the possession guy with a touchdown. Dwayne Allen saw the bulk of the time at tight end because Fleener didn't play. Dwayne Allen, 6 for 75 on 7 touches, on 7 targets. And remember, he's a good blocker, much better blocker than Fleener. You know, Vic Ballard got the start. He was the main ball carrier. Brown is hurting with his knee. He gave him what he could. You know, Vic Ballard got off to a terrible start, 6 carries, negative 3 yards. And then he got it going in the second half. And he's a good player. They like him, and I like the fact they use him a little bit in the passing game. And you saw this. If you watch the game, man, Luck was thrown into everybody in this game. A lot of guys caught passes, and I like that. He is so under control. 30 of 48 for 433. Unbelievable. His passing attempt average was high, and he's been way better, I think, anyone thought of he could be at this point.
Yeah, by the way, that 433 yards, a new rookie single-game record, so congrats to Andrew Luck for that. As we move it over to the Miami Dolphins and their rookie quarterback, Ryan Tannehill, threw for 290 and a touchdown to Charles Clay, who nobody is using for fantasy, but the guys you are using, Reggie Bush had a fantastic touchdown run. I mean, one of the best runs you're ever going to see.
And did nothing really other than that, but the run was one of the best I've seen in years. Now, I got to give Brian Hartline credit. I have him 2 leagues. This is tough. You know, I know he was nursing 2 injuries. I know he's tough because he went through some major health issues in the off season. I wasn't sure if I could use him. You know, it was a tough call, and I wish I used him in 1 league, and not in the other. I wish I would have used him in both. I just didn't have the gazettes to do it. But 8 for 107 on 12 targets, and he's Mr. If the matchup is good, you use him. If it's not, you don't. And he's been good. There's no question about it. Daniel Thomas, I thought, might score a touchdown. He had eight touches. I like that at least they used him a little bit in the passing game, 2 for 25. But quite honestly, they don't have the greatest offense in the world. It'll be interesting to see what happens in the offseason if they draft a receiver in the first round or add a big-time free agent.
Let's move on. We'll go Detroit and Jacksonville, and this one got out of hand early. It was 21-0 at the half. Lions win it 31-14. Mikel LeSure, 3 first-half touchdowns. Now, he finished up 16 carries, 70 yards on the day. Of course, the 3 touchdowns, fantastic numbers if you need them. Joique Bell came in, played a lot in the second half. He was worth using for fantasy today as well. 13 carries, 73 yards, got a late touchdown. He's usually involved in the passing game as well, 3 receptions for 36. So today, one of those rare days where you got 2 running backs, both worth using for fantasy on the same team here for Detroit.
Yeah, I'd hate to be a Jaguar fan. They're just abominable. They're the worst team in the NFL, other than Kansas City, of course. It's just, it's hard to watch them. It really is. They're like pulling teeth. They're just a bad football team. The thing about the Jaguars secondary, though, is they don't give up touchdowns. I don't know what it is. They've been and Rasheem Mathis doesn't even play today, and Cox played with a bad back. And Stafford did not throw a touchdown, threw for 285. And how about Megatron? I mean, I don't know what to tell you. He didn't even practice this week. The knee injury's gotten worse. And he guts it out and has 7 for 129. I mean, I don't know what to tell you. One thing I've learned is with the big-time players, you just play. You play them when they're injured, and you live with it. You know, Jordy Nelson it didn't work. You know, he got hurt, but he suffered another injury. But Calvin was tremendous, and Broyles is playing a lot more now. He had 6 targets, Megatron at 8. How about Joey Bell, 16 touches? And Titus Young, that surprised me. Only 2 for 20 on 5 targets. I know he's had a lingering minor knee injury, but that was disappointing.
Yeah, Titus Young certainly a disappointment today. I'm sure after last week's outburst, a lot of people had him in their lineup today and just 2 for 20. And Matt Stafford is a bit of a head-scratcher. I mean, he played well today, 22 of 33 for 285, no scores. Calvin Johnson did get tackled on the one-yard line. That could have been a touchdown very easily. But through 8 games, he's only got 8 passing touchdowns. So, I mean, he seems to be getting the yards every week, but for whatever reason, the touchdowns just aren't there this year.
Yeah, he's not going to finish in the top 10, probably, unless he starts picking up the touchdowns. But, yeah, yards have been great. I mean, that's been a touch disappointment. Now, I got to give Blaine Gabbert credit. He's playing with a bad left shoulder, okay? He's getting it done the last couple weeks. I mean, Michael Spurlock scores, which is laughable. He's been a kickoff returner, and he's a journeyman receiver. I mean, he's no business scoring. Blackman scored. Cecil Schwartz, you know, not a terrible game, 3 for 56. They got to figure it out offensively. It's been an abomination. They have trouble scoring. Yeah, they put it some garbage time. And Jennings, I mean, at least he got you 15 touches, 12 for 45, and 3 for 7, but he's not a guy who's going to ever score, probably.
Yeah, he's coming off back-to-back 100-total-yard games, so today a little bit of a letdown for him, just 52 total yards. And where are we at with MJD? Do we have any idea when he may be back?
No, the injury was 3 to 5 weeks, so we'll have to see here when he gets back. I mean, it's tough. I mean, you know, he is their offense pretty much. And but again, I give Gabbert some credit. I don't know if I would trust him to pick it up, but at least he's putting some touchdowns lately.
Let's go to Tennessee, where the Titans hosted the Bears today and got destroyed, 51-20. Boy, we don't talk a lot about fantasy defenses, but when we do, we got to talk about the Bears defense. And my goodness, they just find ways to score seemingly every week. I think they've got 8 defensive and special team touchdowns through the first eight games of the season. Just insane. I mean, they had 28 points on the board in the first quarter. And, you know, you watch this defense play, Adam. I mean, it's just unbelievable what they're doing every single week.
It is. And one of the worst, it's really historically bad for fantasy defenses, but Chicago is the rarity. They're unbelievable. They're just, it's crazy what they're doing. But I think it's funny, I had Cutler as a reach. He's been terrible pretty much for fantasy. You know, his yards were way down. He's good, you know, he's barely averaging 200 yards. But Tennessee's defense is so bad and so non-competitive. I was like, you know what, I like Cutler this week. It's the only time I've liked him this season. Now, it was ugly for a while there. And then, don't ask me why, they're throwing the ball up by like 30 points. I'm like, what are they doing? And then Marshall, listen, he's not been a big touchdown guy in his career. He got it done here. Love seeing that. But, again, Cutler didn't have to throw the ball very much. He only threw it 26 times. And Forte, 12 for 103. Armando Allen, 10 for 32. And good to see Forte score again. He's not. Listen, we know he's not a big touchdown guy, but you're loving this if he keeps doing it. I mean, he doesn't have very many touchdowns, my friend, but he did score. He has scored in the last 2 weeks. You'll take it.
Yeah, he looks healthy. He looks really good out there. You mentioned Armando Allen. He got his stats late in garbage time. But Michael Bush, look, the Bears scored 51 points in the game. He got 10 carries, only 16 yards. I mean, if he can't get it done in a game like this, I mean, this game set up perfectly for Michael Bush to come through and get you some fantasy numbers.
Exactly.
At this point, I say the guy's cuttable.
Well, I would only keep him as a handcuff. That's the absolute only reason that I would do that. Now, you know, Titans, this is a very difficult matchup. Now, obviously, Chris Johnson, his 80-yard touchdown was when the Bears were playing prevent. You know, those count, okay? Those count. You take everything you can get from Chris Johnson. I don't know why you would have played him today, but depending on who you had on your roster, but if you played him, you're loving it. because he did score, and he's 16 for 141, and did have four catches, but it's a struggle. They're really a bad team. They're really awful. I don't know how they beat the Steelers. The Steelers suffered like five injuries in that game if they beat them. But, you know, Nate Washington, he did score. He only had two catches. Kendall Wright got hurt in the first half, didn't return, I don't think. I think it maybe an elbow injury. Bottom line is, it's a bad offense. Locker, they don't have a timetable. Other than say they think he'll be back in a couple weeks, but they don't know exactly when, with the fractured left shoulder. So it's a bad team, bad defense. It's hard to watch them.
Yeah, and the other thing, too, is that in a game where you're losing, you know, by 26 points coming out of the first quarter, you'd think there'd be some production there for the passing game for the next three quarters because you're not going to be running it very much. But right. Hasselbeck throws for only 194 and the one touchdown to Nate Washington. A bit surprising there wasn't more passing production to go around late in this.
Now, listen, Chicago is unbelievable. Charles Tillman ought to go to the Hall of Fame. This guy strips more fumbles. And some teams have touchdowns. This guy's unbelievable. And Tillman is just, and he's been pretty good for fantasy over the years. And the thing for him is he's staying healthy. You know, he had problems with injuries over his career. And how about Brian Urlacher with a touchdown? You want to talk about a guy who doesn't run very well anymore, but he still scored. It's great. When you have a bad defense, you just start him. It doesn't matter who they're playing because they get it done every week.
All right. We're going to hop into Carolina and the Washington Redskins. And, boy, a lot of talk this week about Cam Newton and RG3 and how these guys compare to each other. Basically, these two guys don't seem to want to be compared to each other. But in the game today, it certainly was Cam Newton who ended up getting the upper hand as the Carolina Panthers win the game. But if you look at these stats and the way that they project out for the rest of the season, and see if we can get Adam back in here.
I'm here.
Adam, you with us?
I am.
All right, we lost you again.
I don't know what's going on tonight. Yeah, I
don't.
This has happened with Blog Talk over the years. Sometimes it just doesn't work correctly. But anyway, so you're on the Carolina game, I assume?
Yeah, we're doing Carolina-Washington. Just mentioned that, you know, all week people have been trying to compare these two QBs to each other. But, you know, in the end today, certainly Cam Newton had the better game.
You know, it was interesting because he hurt his finger if you watched the first half. And I was like, uh-oh, because he missed Steve Smith early for like a 20 to 25-yard play on the left sideline. You know, he's not playing anywhere nearly as good as last year. You know, Brandon LaFell was out, and I think that hurt him. But he still made plays. And Steve Smith, listen, he showed up today, man. That was a great catch and a great throw by Newton. That was fun to watch. I thought Jonathan Stewart would do better. That was a surprise to me. They still have no rhyme or reason the way they call the running game. Are they running it more? Yeah. But the rotation is impossible to figure out. The problem, it's like you get lucky. It's pure luck if you start the right guy out of their backfield. It's extremely difficult to watch them. But they won. And, you know, right now, I think you look at Washington, I don't know what they're doing, man. It's hard. RG3 has not played well the last 2 weeks. Their defense isn't very good. I mean, this is a team right now, they're in free fall.
Yeah, and it's, you know, you touched on the backfield situation there for the Carolina Panthers, and supposedly there's supposed to be a commitment here to Jonathan Stewart. He did touch the ball 20 times last week. Just 11 touches in this game, though, 51 yards. He didn't score. It's frustrating. I mean, we thought we were getting to a point where you could feel good about starting Stewart, but I don't think we're there.
No, it's just impossible to figure it out. And he was fine, 10 of 51. I thought he'd get a goal line carry or score. It didn't happen. And then, you know, he only has one catch. And I don't know what they're doing with these running backs. Honestly, I said a week ago I'd cut them. There's no reason to have either of them because they don't have a commitment. There's no base run game. But Newton, here's the thing, is he didn't have to throw the ball much. But here's the thing, though, did have a passing touchdown, did have a rushing touchdown, had 37 yards. You'll take it any day of the week. It counts. Now, one thing, let's move over to Washington. I don't think Morris got hurt, and he ran fine. He looked very good. I think Evan Royster might be their hurry-up back. That's the one thing I did notice in that game.
Yeah, I'm not sure if Morris got dinged up late in that, or if they, like you said, if Royster is just sort of the hurry-up guy. I guess we'll have to wait and see what comes out over the next day or so. But, you know, so many injuries with these receivers. Obviously, Fred Davis is out for the year. Pierre Garçon, who knows if he's ever coming back. Yeah. Santana Moss, who had been sort of heating up the last couple of weeks, got knocked out with a concussion today. So it is difficult for RG3. He doesn't have a whole lot to work with right now. You know, Logan Paulson, maybe a guy over the last 3 weeks. I mean, look, we're digging deep here, Adam, but over the last 3 weeks, he's catching 4 or 5 passes every week at tight end for the Redskins.
It's great. I mean, listen, if you look at this situation and you're dying for a tight end, someone's got to catch the football, but he's a blocker. He's really not much of a catcher, but it's a good – Paulson's a good story. Hankerson has had the problem with drops, but he only had 4 targets, 3 for 49, and Josh Morgan starts because he blocks really well in the run game, led them by far with 12 targets, Paulson at 8. It's hard to watch them. I mean, it's getting harder and harder for RG3. The only saving grace for him without a touchdown, he did it 53 yards on the ground.
Let's move on. We'll go to Tampa Bay at Oakland, and this is an exciting game. And, of course, the big story coming out of this game is Doug Martin. Wow, what a game that this guy had today. 4 touchdowns on the day, 3 of them at least 45 yards in length. That's the first time that has ever happened in the history of the league, which is unbelievable that he got that done today. Also broke James Wilder's team rushing record for a single game set back in 1980. I mean, just an all-time great performance today by Doug Martin. And as we acknowledged a couple of days ago, Adam, they're doing it with kind of a patchwork offensive line right now.
Yeah, both starting guards are out. And you know, it's interesting. I know fantasy owners were down on Martin for a while. He had a problem in the middle of the season. I mean, he had 3 straight games without scoring, 3 straight games with 4 straight games with under 100 yards. But last 3 games, 85, 135, 251. The thing he's not doing, I'd like to see more receptions. A little disappointing that he only has 16, but the last 2 games, a monster. I mean, it's really incredible what he's done the last 2 weeks. 386 yards on 54 carries, and here's a guy I know could handle a lot of work. He's a special player. I mean, a lot of people compare him to Emmitt Smith because, you know, the way he stops and starts. I get that. He's fun. He's fun to watch, and they drafted him for a reason because they wanted him to be the foundation of their offense. It's not about Josh Freeman. He's got 11 touchdowns in his last 4 games. I mean, he's coming on, and because their defense is not very good, he's having to throw, and it's coming through.
Yeah, and now another thing we need to – I'm sorry, I dropped out for a second there, Adam, but okay. Darren McFadden in this game left with a leg injury, and, you know, you hate to say the guy was due, but they've been really working him hard. He's been getting a lot of touches each and every week. We know he's had injury problems over the years. He left with the leg today. Do we have any early word on what's going on with him?
Yeah, ESPN has reported that it's a high ankle sprain. He's going to have an MRI tomorrow. And there are 2 types of high ankle sprains. There's the mild, which is anywhere from 2 to 3 weeks. There's the dreaded, which is anywhere from 6 to 8 weeks. I don't feel real good about it. McFadden, obviously, has been a bust. There's no other way around it. And you know, today, unfortunately, his day ended early. First couple runs were good. Then he struggled on a couple runs. But I got to give Palmer credit. His no-slot receiver had another big game. Unfortunately, had a couple big interceptions late, which killed him. But he had 61 attempts, Paul.
Yeah, wow. I mean, when you throw the ball that many times, certainly the numbers are going to be there at the end of the day. Tight end Brandon Myers, a guy who normally catches passes for this team. He's been putting up some pretty good yardage totals. Finally scored a couple of times today. And, you know, if he can score with any kind of regularity, I mean, he's going to be somebody really that you can feel good about using at tight end.
Yeah, this is Brandon Myers never scores, but you know, he did today, and he had 13 targets. I mean,
wow.
You know, because remember, Ford was their slot receiver, Jacoby Ford. They don't have one, so he is the intermediate short area guy. He doesn't catch the ball ever downfield. So that's exactly what he's doing. Rod Streeter had a big touchdown catch. He also missed on a big play. Denarius Moore, disappointing, 4 for 66. Considering that Palmer threw it 61 times, I thought he would have had some big plays. Now, Marcel Reese, 8 for 95. He had 9 targets, 8 catches. That's huge. He had to play a lot because remember, Mike Goodson also got hurt. So they can't stand Tywan Jones' staff. They inherited him. He's always hurt, and they just don't trust the guy.
Yeah. Yep. All right. Let's go ahead and move on.
He's going to have to play though. Now he's going to have to play. He's very explosive, but there's no way you can count on this guy in any way, shape, or form.
Minnesota and Seattle. Boy, a lot more scoring in this game than I figured there would be. But Seattle takes care of the Vikings at home behind Russell Wilson, who Don't look now, but he's got 8 touchdowns in the last 4 games. Now, he's probably not on anybody's roster at this point, but is he getting to a point, Adam, where he should at least be on the radar?
Well, I think you're talking about Sidney Rice. I could barely hear you.
Oh, I'm sorry. No, talking about Russell Wilson. He's got 8 touchdowns the last 4 weeks.
Not really, unless you're in a 2-quarterback league and you're hurting. Now, you look at the last 2 weeks, though. I mean, I know he's 5 touchdowns, but week 7, 9 for 23 and 122 without a touchdown. Got to be careful. Now, Minnesota's defense is struggling mightily. But the guy I pick up is Sidney Rice. I mean, Sidney Rice, the thing for him is he's healthy. He's had the shoulder problems or whatever. He scored in the last 2 weeks. He's not terrible. He has 28 catches in the season, which is not a lot, but he's coming on a little bit. You know what? He has 10 catches in the last 2 weeks with 12 targets. He scored 3 out of the last 4 weeks. He's not a bad number 3 receiver right now.
Yeah. Now, last week, Golden Tate caught 7 passes, 64 yards, and today gets in the end zone a couple of times. So, they're trying to get him the ball. He does seem to make plays when he gets the ball. So, I mean, if he can get consistent touches in this offense, he may be a guy who you can feel pretty good about.
Oh, yeah. No, Golden Tate, he's amazing. He had the crazy game against the Packers, obviously.
Yep.
Now, he only has 3 touchdowns on the season. So, it's not crazy. He only has 6 for his career, so let's not go crazy here. But, listen, I mean, they're going to throw the ball. Their defense is not nearly as good as we thought it would be. They're starting to fall off a little bit. Their run defense is surprising me. They're giving up some plays, but I think when you look at Golden Tate, he's not a bad low end number 3 receiver, and he's got a 13 targets in his last 2 games. And again, you could do worse.
Yeah, and of course for the Seahawks, really offensively, it's all about running the football with Marshawn Lynch, 124 yards and a touchdown today. That's now 3 games in a row over 100 yards. As far as being the model of consistency, I think Marshawn Lynch is it. He has run for less than 85 yards exactly once this season. So, I mean, you can count on this guy to get his numbers each and every week.
Amazing how good this guy is, and he's not slowing down at all. They ride this guy big time. And, you know what's crazy? It seems like he's been in the league like 8 or 9 years. He only turns 27 in April.
This
guy is big time. He is big time. The only thing, though, Paul, he's not doing, scoring a lot of touchdowns. That to me is surprising. Only has 3 touchdowns, but the yard has been fantastic.
Giants and Steelers at MetLife Stadium today. Very physical game that the Steelers ended up winning, 24-20. So we will start with the Steelers on offense and. They've been running the ball really well without Rashard Mendenhall. Last couple of weeks, Jonathan Dwyer had back-to-back 100-yard games. Today, Dwyer was out as well, so Isaac Redman had to step up. And 26 carries for 147 and a touchdown. He looked really good. And, you got to give a lot of credit, clearly, to the Steeler offensive line.
Yeah, and Paul, he was unbelievable with running after contact. And Willie Colon, who moved from right tackle to guard, is having a Pro Bowl-type season. Their passing game is not clicking today at all. I mean, if you have Roethlisberger starting, you'll feel fortunate you got 2 touchdowns. Mike Wallace is not having the kind of year you probably like, but he is scoring some touchdowns. Mild high ankle sprain is the early word on Antonio Brown. That typically is somewhere between 3 and 4 weeks. For receiver, it's not good. And whatever testing they have, let's hope it's not worse than that. Heath Miller, the bubble bursted. He didn't score. He got his usual catches, 4 for 48, but he didn't score. Cotri had to fill in. Sanders did score. But, Emmanuel Sanders, I believe, will be the guy who would start, but we'll find out later in the week. But Redman, I got to give him credit. He was tremendous.
Yeah, really good game today for him. And Heath Miller, 4 for 48. That's typical. Like you said, he does tend to score more often than not. And you figure the Giants, after what Jason Witten did against them last week, that Heath Miller maybe would have done a little bit more than he did. But 4 for 48 for Heath Miller today as we transition over to the New York Giants. And, boy, it was ugly on offense for the Giants today. And that starts with Eli Manning, who only completed 10 passes on the day, 125 yards, no touchdowns again this week. He did throw an INT. When you look at him over the last month, Adam, he's thrown for under 200 yards in 3 of his last 4 games, and he's only got 2 touchdown passes in those last 4 games.
Yeah, I actually put out the complete numbers on Twitter earlier today, and it was alarming. I mean, it was bad, and I kind of knew, and I kind of told people this might happen with Ahmad Bradshaw. He's got the bad feet. He barely practices, and they clearly do not want him in short yardage situations because that is a power play where the running back has got the power out of his stance, and they just don't want him doing it. And tell you what, Andre Brown does not get a lot of work, but he did score again, and he's not. If you're in a TD only league, or if you're looking for a flex option, he did score his fifth time this season. I think he scored three or four out of the. I think three games in a row here. Let me just double check this. Yeah, he scored in each of his last three games, and I mean Bradshaw to me would be a guy I'd trade. I mean absolutely. Now Brown did ding his shoulder a little bit. He said he's going to be okay. We'll see how the testing goes, but I would be trading Ahmad Bradshaw for as much as I can get.
Victor Cruz caught 5 balls for 67. He got popped in the end zone, and good to see him come back in the game and even catch a couple of passes after that. But Hakeem Nicks, just 1 catch, 10 yards. Clearly his owners are very frustrated right now, Adam. What do you think is happening with Hakeem Nicks?
Well, the whole pass game, Eli is not seeing the field clearly. Nicks has been a bust. There's no other way around it. He's constantly hurt. Now he's not even on the injury report, and actually he was probable, but he's not doing anything. I mean, he has not scored since September 16th at home in that crazy game against the Bucks when he was great.
Right.
This is unbelievable. I mean, he has not had over 53 yards in any of his last 4 games. It is really bottom out for Hakeem Nicks.
Wow, terrible. And as we're doing this, we have just gotten into the third quarter here on Sunday Night Football. 6-6, no touchdowns yet in this game. And, looking at what we've got so far, a little bit over one half's worth of action. Tony Romo's thrown for 153. He's almost thrown a couple of picks. I mean, he certainly, I don't know what it is, Adam. I don't know if he's just careless with the football. I don't know if it's his receivers maybe breaking off routes in places where they're not supposed to be breaking them off. But, boy, he's come awfully close to turning it over a couple times already tonight.
Yeah, it's been hard. I mean, first of all, they should be up in this game by a big amount, and they're not because they stink in the red zone. And Witten, I had a feeling because the Falcons safety has been playing well that Witten might come back to earth here, and that's kind of what we're seeing, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And I needed him to come up big, and it doesn't look like it. But I got to give both defenses credit. I mean, they're playing very well. Numbers aren't there. Tony Romo has been pretty much a big disappointment for fantasy owners this season. I'm not sure what to say here. Des Bryant gutted it out with a bad hip. Julio's the only guy who's really been doing anything for Atlanta tonight. I don't know why they're even running. They might as well just throw all game. And quite frankly, looks like they're gonna do that. But I give Felix Jones credit. He's playing hurt tonight for Murray. They don't know when Murray's going to be out. Ogletree has that big catch that was a bomb. I was shocked. I thought that would be Austin or Bryant, but it was not.
All right, Adam, that'll just about do it for us. Tomorrow night we got the Eagles, we got the Saints, so good luck to everybody who's still got players going tonight. Good luck again tomorrow night. For Adam Kaplan, I'm Paul Kelly. This has been Week 9 of the FantasyGuru.com Sunday Night Wrap-Up Podcast. We will talk to you next time.
Blog Talk Radio, where millions of hosts and listeners gather.